By now, most people have likely heard about cryptocurrency at some point in the recent years, but very few really understand how it all works. Cryptocurrency is a fully digital currency that requires no affiliation with governments or banks. The word crypto is derived from the Greek word kruptos, which loosely translates to hidden or secret. But is it really a secure form of currency? What if your investments in cryptocurrency and its various forms, such as Bitcoin, Ethereum, and many others, suddenly vanishes into thin air? Who will be responsible for this loss? Today, we will attempt to understand what cryptocurrency is and how it works by exploring some of the underlying principles behind this concept. But before we begin, be sure to subscribe to our channel for more content ahead. Cryptocurrency is a type of digital asset that is an intangible digital currency that uses a highly sophisticated type of encryption called cryptography to secure and verify transactions as well as control the creation of new units of currency. It is a form of payment that can be exchanged online for goods and services. We can think of it as virtual casino chips or arcade tokens. It is designed to work as a decentralized medium of exchange. It is independent of any financial institution or any other central authority. So, how do cryptocurrencies generate value with no government or bank behind it? The concept is simple. Just like how people believe and trust in the value of paper currency, the same thing applies to cryptocurrencies. If enough people agree that cryptocurrencies have value, then they simply just do. Now that we understand this concept, how did this decentralized system of fully digital currency first come into existence? It was first introduced by an anonymous programmer or a group of programmers under the alias Satoshi Nakamoto in the form of Bitcoin. Bitcoin was introduced in 2008 as a concept for the world's first decentralized digital currency. It is a peer-to-peer payment system that operates without any middleman or a central repository like a bank. Bitcoin has consistently dominated the crypto market since it became available to the public in 2009. It has remained relatively unchallenged until the introduction of the Ethereum platform in 2016. So what is really all of this? And could anyone make their own form of digital currency if they wanted to? If so, how would one even achieve such a task? Well, in order to understand how this works, we must first look at the concept of a ledger. A ledger is a book or collection of accounts in which account transactions are recorded. Each account has an opening or carry forward balance that records transactions as either a debit or credit. In our current economical system, only the central authority can add or remove lines or transactions on a ledger. However, in a cryptocurrency like Bitcoin, the ledger is publicly shared and anyone can add or subtract transactions on it. Now, how can we trust that everyone will be honest and not include any fraudulent transactions? This is where cryptography comes in. Every participant on the ledger must verify their transactions with a digital signature. Now, in order to deter forgery of these digital signatures, cryptography implements a public key and a private key in the form of some string of binary digits containing about 256 bits for all participants. So, as the name implies, private key is something that only the individual that it is assigned to knows, while the public key is available for anyone to check. So, using a mathematical function dependent on the private key and the transaction, only the person who is assigned the private key can come up with a unique digital signature. If someone were to try and forge this signature, it would require changing the transaction itself, which would in turn change the signature. Also, another function using the public key and signature itself can be used to easily verify whether the signature is correct. But to go the other way and trying to figure out the correct signature, one would have to go through 2 to the power of 256 possible signatures, which is next to impossible thanks to cryptography. But this still doesn't solve the problem of someone just making multiple copies of the signed transactions. To counter this is rather simple. each transaction must be accompanied by a unique identity. So anytime a transaction is copied on the ledger, it will have a different ID associated with it. Now, this is all great, but how we share this ledger with everyone is at the heart of cryptocurrency. Sharing this ledger even on a public domain such as a website is still considered centralized. This is because someone must own the website and hence they could dictate the rules of adding and subtracting transactions from the ledger. So to get rid of the middleman, what cryptocurrency does is that it has everyone keep their own record of the ledger. So when someone makes a transaction, they must announce it to everyone so that they can all record it on their own private copies of the ledger. But the same problem still persists. How can we deter fraudulent transactions? And how would anyone know that all these transactions are being written down in the same order on everyone's private ledger? This is where another great solution offered by cryptography is introduced in the form of a cryptographic hash function. A cryptographic hash function inputs any kind of encryption or file and puts a string of bits with some fixed length. For example, the hash function for Bitcoin is SHA-256 with some kind of input that outputs a fixed length of 256 binary digits. What makes this cryptographic hash function so interesting is the fact that every output is highly unpredictable. So trying to reverse engineer it and obtain the input would require trial and error of 2 to the power of 256 possible outcomes. Now, to make a ledger legitimate, the protocol of Bitcoin dictates that a ledger must include a special number so that when it is applied to the SHA-256 hash function, it gives an output with a certain number of leading zeros in the binary code. This number of leading zeros changes periodically based on an approximate solution time of about 10 minutes for Bitcoin, but varies for other cryptocurrencies. This special number and the computational work required to obtain it is what is called the proof of work. Without this proof of work, the ledger is not legitimate. So coming back to the problem of transactions being legitimate, what happens is that every ledger is organized into blocks that contain signed transactions and a proof of work. Moreover, each successive block must contain the output of the hash function of the previous block, so it is easier to organize and almost impossible to change any of the transactions or the order of the blocks. Now, since all the blocks are in order and linked together, they are commonly referred to as a blockchain. So anyone in the world could potentially collect and organize all the broadcasted transactions, find a unique number that produces a given output of the hash function, and then broadcast it back to everyone to be included in the blockchain. This is the concept of mining cryptocurrencies. However, mining is extremely competitive and requires significant computing power in order to be the first to solve a cryptographic puzzle of the blockchain algorithm. If successful, a miner gets a special reward in the form of crypto coins, which they can include in the block without the need of any special digital signature. However, some cryptocurrencies have a finite limit of the total coins one can mine. For example, there can only be a total of 21 million bitcoins in circulation. But not all cryptocurrencies have a hard limit. Some have a fixed rate of new coin creation instead. Regardless, miners can still make money through transaction fees even when all the bitcoins or any other finite cryptocurrency have all been mined. Now, because of the incentive of getting paid in crypto coins, miners rush to figure out solutions to the hash function. But of course, even then, some fraudulent blocks could slip in and create invalid blockchains misguiding the listener. To counter this is very simple. Anyone listening should wait for the additional blocks to be announced and simply trust the blockchain with the greatest number of blocks. Trusting the longest blockchain is equivalent to trusting the most computational work, which is the underlying idea of blockchain technology. This way, it becomes possible to arrive at a decentralized consensus, meaning that there no longer exists a need for central authorities like banks and governments to regulate transactions. So, to answer what is cryptocurrency is fundamentally the history of transactions where every participating member is the central authority, so no one really is. And that is the concept behind cryptocurrency. What do you think about the future of cryptocurrency and whether investing in it is the way to go? And will cryptocurrency and blockchain really become mainstream within the next 5 or 10 years? Well, that is a discussion for another time. If you enjoyed this video, do leave a like, share, and subscribe to our channel for more content ahead. Until then, we'll see you in the next one.